Thank you very much for this opportunity and for inviting me to be able to share my views and some of my learnings in the area of early childhood education with all of you. First of all, I'd like to congratulate you on this very momentous occasion of 10 years of Akshara Foundation. It's really a very significant milestone, I think, in the life of any institution, and especially one which is doing such laudable work and for children. As I was telling Ashok a minute back, that I have come primarily with the idea of learning more from your experience here, because now that I'm associated with the Delhi Trust of Pratham more significantly, we would like to take a lot of learnings back from here and try to implement some of that there. Having said that, since I have 5 minutes, no, how many, 10 minutes only, I think I'll have to race through my slides, because I have slides, unfortunately. I'll just take up the most significant thing in each slide, because, and please pardon me if those slides just flash past without any, sorry?
No, they're wondering whether they need to get up, it's okay.
No. Okay. Well, they get a crick in the neck if they want to see the slide. Maybe you could tell me when the 10 minutes start. Okay, anyway, I'll start it for myself. I think the most significant line in this slide is the one at the bottom. The early years of a child's life last a lifetime. I don't think I have to say anything new in this presentation to a group of people who are really committed already to this field. I think all I can do is reassure you that you're on the right track. That's about all this presentation will do to you, because I see a group of people, so it's like talking to the converted. But anyway, sorry, I'm jumping. I don't think I need to go into this. Most people have a lot of confusion about early childhood education in terms of the acronyms that we use, ECC, EC, EC, ECD, PSC, so on and so forth. Just last week, somebody was telling me he met a director who said, what are you talking about early childhood education? We are dealing with preschool, non-formal education. So that kind of a thing. So again, I don't think I need to go into what early childhood education is. But essentially here and globally now, we are talking about early childhood education and development. One, in an integrated mode, where we are talking about health, nutrition, water, sanitation, education, all to be seen together as very critical for the development and education of children. And the second thing is, we are talking about the education, the span, that is from birth to 8 years, not just 6 years. I think I'll just dwell a little more on this, because here, this is where the confidence building comes, that we are all on the right track. There is a lot of, initially there was more of conjecture and speculation, but now there is very confirmed evidence, particularly from neuroscience and economics, on how important the early years are. There is global research now which shows that having compensated for the home background, especially with the children who are coming from poorer backgrounds, there is not only immediate impact, medium-term impact, but long-term impact. And that has been confirmed across countries, but largely in the Western world. It has shown that there is improvement not only in children's health, cognitive ability, academic performance, and school retention. Shantaji was talking about the whole issue, concerns about dropouts. In India itself, we have evidence of almost 38,000 children, with the study that I was associated with, where we found that it made a difference of almost as much as 10 to 15% in the retention rates of children if they had just been to a preschool, irrespective of the quality, merely participation. But the most significant point here is the long-term benefits. That is where early years of a child's life last a lifetime. There's enough research now to show that participation in a good quality preschool program benefits in terms of higher incomes later, higher incidence of home in ownership, which is an indicator of prosperity, lower propensity to be on welfare, and lower rates of incarceration and arrest. So you can see what a kind of a latent impact there is, which can be captured even in the adult life, just mere participation. And no wonder we say these are the formative years, or these are the years, in Hindi we say sanskar bachchon ke padte hain. This is another confidence building slide. which shows why are we so much stuck on preschool? Why are we saying that preschool is so important or early years are so important? Because here, as you can see, the brain development, the cumulative brain growth that takes place in the child, as you can see from this slide, almost 85% is already done by the time the child is 2.5 years old. So it's even 3 to 6 sometimes becomes late because it is more important to focus right in the beginning when the child is not even two, in the first 2 years of life, where nutrition can play a very significant role, and that is a stage when nutrition becomes a very important intervention. So we need to think in terms of early childhood education and development more holistically and ensure that the child's nutritional status, the water sanitation facilities, all those are also taken care of if we want children to really learn well. This is another slide which has some implications for the curriculum. I find this again from brain research, which shows that many of the competencies that we talk about, cognitive, social, are the critical period for development of those competencies actually lies in the early 6 years. If you see from this red bands that you can see here, you can see, for example, peer social skills. Like it starts from 3.5 to 6.5. This is the age group when it is very critical. So when we are expecting our 2-year-old and a 2.5-year-old to start sharing and cooperating and playing with other children, are we not being unrealistic? That is because the child is not yet mature. So this brings in the whole issue of maturity, readiness, and the importance to strike when it is hot. That is when the critical period is there, because that is a time when the child learns very fast. For example, language, if you see, the language bar is from, say, 6 months to 4.5 years. And that is a time when the child must get a very good language environment. We are so concerned about reading. Reading is also a language skill, but it is also goes very integrally with listening and speaking. And if the child gets a very rich, very good environment in the first 4 years of life, the child is bound to push on to effective reading and writing skills as well. So these are some of the critical periods that we need to address, and therefore the importance of what we should do in preschool, what we should be doing in order to promote and make the most of the opportunity of these critical periods. This is the economic argument, which again says that there is significant returns from early childhood investment, and especially when you compare in terms of the wastage and stagnation that happens at the primary stage. This evidence is from Brazil, which says that total costs of schooling, including the early learning program for pupils up to grade 2, was 11% lower for those who participated in ECCE as compared to those who did not. This is an argument for the government that we are often told when we are trying to advocate for investment in early childhood that when we don't have funds for primary, how can we have funds for early childhood? So the amount of saving that can happen at the primary stage if you invest in early childhood. And a recent longitudinal study has indicated that the returns are to the tune of 12.1. Every dollar invested gives you a return of $12.9 saved. I think I'll skip this. Basically, it's the same thing that what are the main learnings that are coming, and they're related to the continuum and to the holistic development of children. This one I will not even attempt to decipher for you. It's only to tell you that there's enough policy. There are any number of policies in the country related to children, but we know what the situation is on the ground. ECE rights issue has already been mentioned by Shantaji in the morning, that we are very concerned that it has not been included in the right to education. It started from only 6 years, and the first 6 years have been left out. It has been provided for under Section 11 as governments may make necessary arrangements for preschool education. So the may word again puts it in a little bit of a hold. I was very happy to see that Karnataka government has in their model, what do they call, rules, included preschool education. So I think that's really a landmark initiative and needs to be emulated by others. Another thing that we need to be very clear on is what are the priorities. When we are talking about the right to education and the right for the early childhood, there are two different things when we talk of school education and when we talk about early childhood. But school education, to my mind, is a much simpler concept because it is about providing schools, ensuring children come into schools and so on, and that's it. Here we are talking about a very different cup of tea, because here the priorities at the different sub-stages are very different. What they are, I won't go into because of my time shortage, but we must take that into cognizance, that it involves health, it involves nutrition, it involves care, and therefore, I don't think that, I mean, we need to advocate, but we need to also work out how this right will be implemented. What will be the costs involved? What will be the strategies involved? And here I see Archana here, and I was hoping that we could do something together on this in terms of the legal requirements of this. These are all figures, data. We all know about all this. Essentially, a very significant equity issue, early childhood education. We all know rural-urban divide. We know the gender. I don't know about Karnataka, but across the country, where parents can afford even a little, they perceive the quality of the private preschools is better than the Anganwadis, and therefore the boys go to the private preschools and the girls go to the Anganwadis. So I don't know what is the situation in India, in Karnataka. There are huge variations interstate and so on. Socioeconomic is also very significant. When I was looking at this, the title of the colloquium today, equitable quality for all, and I was trying to unpack it in my own mind, that what does equitable quality really mean? It does not necessarily mean the same quality that is available to a child from a better socioeconomic background, because what his receptivity, his own preparation to utilize that facility also has to be taken into account. So when we are talking about equitable quality, we have to ensure that the child is at the same level to be able to take advantage of whatever is offered to the child. And I think that's where very significantly early childhood education comes in to compensate for that deprivation. What are the main issues here? I'll just quickly run through them. One of them is the developmentally inappropriate practice in terms of the curriculum, and there's no standards for preschool education. And therefore what is happening is that there is very little understanding of what should happen at the preschool stage. And I would just like to dwell a little more on this particular slide, because I think it is important from the point of view of advocating for the right kind of preschool education. I will go back to the slide I showed you on the critical bands in the from the brain research, and say that it is what is happening at the moment is, whether it is a public sector or the private sector, there is a lot of downward extension of the primary curriculum. Even now, our first effort is to start teaching children reading and writing and numbers, whether they are 2 years old, 3 years old, or 6 years old. So somewhere we have to take this into account, that what is happening by way of putting that kind of academic pressure or converting the program of early childhood into a primary curriculum. I think basically what happens is there's not enough acknowledgement of the fact that the child at that stage is not really maturationally or experientially ready for the curriculum at the primary stage, and which shows up later. How does it show up later is, there are many people who say that, I think this thinking is outdated. Now children can learn much more. You send children to a preschool, they learn alphabets, they learn numbers, they learn how to read and write, they do mathematics. So what is the problem? Where is the problem? Now again, this impact on children, I think that is what we need to really take in very seriously. This is again coming from research, it is not my own concoction. First of all, when we are introducing, for example, mathematics concepts too early, simple number concept even, leave alone addition or subtraction, too early, the child is not maturationally ready for it. So how does the child learn? The child is able to deliver essentially because the child rote memorizes. And all the answers, the right answers the child gets, the A's the child gets, do not really reflect that the child has really understood the concepts. And what happens is, it gives a very weak foundation for all subsequent learning, because that is what builds the curriculum further. The second point is a very interesting point. This was given by Professor Lillian Katz, who's a very well-known educationist in early childhood scientist, I would say, in US. She's given this whole concept of damaged disposition hypothesis. When we're talking about the methodologies for teaching reading and writing, when we're talking about the curriculum, we normally take into cognizance what is the cognitive aspect of it, but we don't take into cognizance what is the attitudinal, interest, motivational aspects related to it. And what this has shown is that if you introduce academic instruction too early in life, in the early childhood years, what happens is the children do learn. They learn the skills. It's not that they don't learn, but because of the pressure or the unrealistic expectation involved, they develop a negative association with that learning. And as a result, the skills are learned. It becomes counterproductive. The skills are learned, but the disposition to use those skills is reduced. I don't know whether the point has come through clearly, but basically you won't find children really interested in reading as much as they would be, because the association with reading has become a negative association related to school and pressure. A third point is,